just to take you back, I'm going to just briefly touch on last week's discussion that we, you know, when we talk about the reliability of the Bible, let me just rehash for you. We believe that there are things that are difficult to understand, difficult to reconcile in the Bible, but we do not believe that there are absolute flat contradictions in the Bible that would dismiss it out of hand. And I would challenge anyone that says that to bring them to me, because I just don't believe that you're gonna find something that frankly is unexplainable there inexplicable. In my estimation, everything that you bring would be able to be explained in some way, shape, or form. All right. So I say that, and yet I remind you that we believe that it is God's word. It is a faith statement. I say that often because a Christian, the Bible has many things that prove it. There's no question about that. And by the way, we're going to talk a little bit about archaeology pointing to the scriptures, but many things that prove it, but you are not going to flat out prove to someone that the Bible is the word of God. It is a faith statement born of the Holy Spirit, all right? I will, you know, the last thing I will say is just again to remind you, it is an amazing book. And it is bolstered over and over again by archaeology, okay? I've said it many times to you, archaeology is our friend. And I say that because if you look at that quote under A4C, it begins the Dead Sea Scrolls. So this is Dr. Peter Flint. I drew this interview from Associates for Biblical Research. He said this: "The Dead Sea Scrolls are the greatest find of our time. They affect our understanding of the Bible, and I think that this is critical, what he's about to say. They confirm the accuracy of Scripture. They enhance our understanding of Jesus and help us to interpret the New Testament." Again, because they're Old Testament documents. But what I would recommend to you, again, if you don't know anything about the Dead Sea Scrolls, I would encourage you to find out about them. An amazing find that God provided. I think there's no question that God brought that about, okay? So, again, I simply make the point, that last paragraph in your study guide, that when there are difficulties, we just seek to reconcile them. The example that I used last week is that Matthew and Luke have different genealogies of Jesus. We know that that's true. They start from a different place even, by the way. But the best explanation that I have walked away with is that Matthew's genealogy of Jesus is from Joseph's line, and Luke's genealogy of Jesus is from Mary's line. And I think that that's a good and solid explanation. All right, so question number five then. Again, we bolster the veracity, the truth of the scriptures. But so the question comes, how can we know that God exists? Now, this, of course, for a Christian person is just something that you take for granted, that God, in fact, exists. And yet, I would suggest to you that it is the only logical explanation, and some people laugh at me about that because they say, no, it's your faith statement. Well, it is a faith statement. There's no question about that, but it is the only logical explanation for what? For you and me and the earth and the universe. As I often say it, the junk that we see in the universe requires a putter therer of the junk, right? Somebody had to put it into place. Somebody had to bring it into being. It's the only logical answer. Now, we're going to come to the question, well, if we believe God exists, what existed before him? Now, you know, at some point, your brain is going to turn to mush and leak out on your pillow when you keep going on the philosophies, right? But we start with, what other explanation is there? Well, interestingly, you've probably heard some of them. And one of them is, it's very popular with a guy that I do not like very much. I pray for him often, and I pray for myself because I don't like him very much. His name is Stephen Hawking. Maybe you've heard of him. Stephen Hawking is the gentleman that's a very brilliant man, or at least by all accounts a very brilliant man, that is crumpled up and in a wheelchair and has all sorts of theories for how the universe came into being. Stephen Hawking, to my knowledge, is the one that came up with what is called the God particle. The God particle says, the theory is, that the universe actually self-generated. He believes that there was a little particle that can, in his, again, way out of my league, I mean, I don't understand a lot of what he talks about, frankly, but can, in fact, self-generate this particle. And so this particle self-generated and it created, I'm using that terminology intentionally, created the universe as we know it. The problem with Stephen Hawking's thing is this. Where did the particle come from? You got to keep going back to that thing. In order for us to logically explain the existence of the universe, there has to be the way that theologians often say it is this, an uncaused causer. An uncaused causer. In other words, a God who had no beginning or end that caused everything to come into being, okay? So an uncaused causer. There has to have been that. It's, again, I'm just going to set my faith aside for a second, understanding that I can't really get it out of my system because I am a Christian, but set my faith aside for a second and just say, it's logical. Of course there has to be a creator God, you know. We'll do this a little bit more when we come to the evolution segment, and that'll be shortly. But the example that we always use with children is this. If I told you that there was nothing, and then all of a sudden this watch just showed up, all its parts working together, all the hands doing its thing, all the springs, the battery, the wristband, the clasp, all of that stuff came together. It wasn't there, and then it was there. Well, what would you say? You know, Joe, you might want to lay off the sauce, right? You might want to stop drinking so much, right? Well, you know, in order for this watch to come into being, there had to be a watchmaker. There had to be someone that put it together, all right? And so that's really more of an evolution discussion, but it's also a where did the junk come from discussion. You got to come to that conclusion. By the way, and I hadn't heard this until recently, but there are scientists that, let me see if I got him. Yeah. So there's an article that I quote there. The last name of the scientist is Vilenkin. If you want to look at that, it is Cosmologies. That's where it starts under Q5. I think I put that in answer five, right? Yeah, answer five. So the second, I made it italicized, so it reads this way. It is cosmology's most fundamental question, how did the universe begin? The question presupposes that the universe had an actual starting point, but one might just as well assume the universe always was and always will be. Now, what's the problem with that? Vilenkin actually has a God. It's the universe. It always was and always will be. Well, that's the definition of God, right? And so his God is, in fact, the universe. Let me just finish what this article says. In that case, there would be no beginning whatsoever, just an ever-evolving story of which we're catching a mere glimpse. We have very good evidence that there was a Big Bang. So the universe as we know it almost certainly started some 14 billion years ago. Again, let me just remind you, the 14 billion is an assumption and a presupposition on their part. Because understand that in order for evolution to be true, they have a phrase, if given enough time. And so what they have done is made it so there was enough time for all this stuff to come to pass. Because in their estimation, and I am going to do my best to debunk this, everything that we see takes a really long time for it to happen. All right, so 14 billion is an assumption. Let me remind you of something, Christian. The theory of Big Bang, the theory of evolution, remains a theory. And in fact, it's not even scientific. Because in order for it to be scientific, it has to be observable and repeatable. And macroevolution, and there is a difference between macro and micro, macroevolution is neither observable nor repeatable. And so it's not science, it's a theory. It remains a theory that is now taught to our children, and yes, I'm not thrilled about this, but shoved down our children's throats as fact, when it's not. In fact, most of you have heard me tell this story, but when Benjamin, my second son, was a sophomore in high school, he had a test on evolution, and he was asked to write down one, two, three proofs for evolution, and he wrote, there are none. the teacher was a Christian, and she said, I couldn't exactly argue with him because he was right. So, all right. So, let me take you back to the sentence. It always will be, oh, I'm sorry, no, the 14 billion, that's where I stopped, 14 billion years ago. But was that the absolute beginning, or was there something before it, asks this scientist, Alexander Vilenkin. He's a cosmologist, that just means a guy that studies the universe, at Tufts University near Boston. It seems like the kind of question that can never be truly answered, because every time someone proposes a solution, someone else can keep asking the annoying question, what happened before that? Now, Vilenkin says that he has convincing evidence in hand. The universe had a distinct beginning, though he can't pinpoint the time. After 35 years of looking backward, he says he's found that before our universe, there was nothing, nothing at all, not even time itself. And every Christian in the room goes, you're right. And then God said, let there be light. And everything started, you see. Now, for them, they, of course, come to a different presupposition. I get it. I have my presuppositions, they have theirs, and I have to admit mine just as much as I hope they're willing to admit theirs. The flaw, though, in his theory is that it always has been. That is illogical without God in the picture, okay? So let's look at a couple. This is none of these verses I'm going to take you to are a big shocker to you, all right? So look at Psalm 19:1. However, they're not a big shock, but I do want you to have them. So Psalm 19:1, and this is such a short one, I should have just written it into your study guide, but so Psalm 19:1 reads this way, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. I noticed that some of you don't have the study guide, so I probably should write this up there. So the idea with Psalm 19:1 is just a reminder that, in fact, I've done this with people that struggle with the existence of God. I've actually taken them outside and at night and shown them the sky and say to them, you know, why does this stuff just sit out there? Why doesn't it just come a crashing down, right? And of course, explain to them how big our universe really is. In fact, I should, if I can remember to do this, it's kind of long for a Bible study time. It's 23 minutes long, but it's this wonderful take. They go from the earth all the way out to the outer reaches of what we would know as the universe and then come back. It's really an amazing thing. But the long and the short of this video is to remind us just how big this place really is. And again, that bigness, as we've talked about many times, screams out there had to be a big guy with a big G, capital G, right? A big guy that brought this into being. So the other verse is Romans 1, and I give you 18 to 31, but I'm actually going to stop before 31 because it gets into a whole different discussion. So Romans 1, beginning in verse 18, and again, I'll write it on the board for you. I'll just put 18 to wherever we stop. So Romans chapter 1, verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. Now, this is one of the most pertinent verses, for what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Now, I'm just going to stop there. The point that Paul is making in this segment of Romans is just a reminder that though it was quite obvious from creation that there was a God, they would instead, well, let's go to the Egyptians, fashion God in the nature of created things, like, you know, cats and dogs and eagles and all of that stuff, which were obviously, quite obviously, had to be made by something bigger than the cat or the eagle or the dog or vulture, whatever their God happened to be. Now, notice, but I didn't think about this until just now, but notice then that when God came against them with the plagues in Egypt, what did he attack? All the plagues were attacks on their gods, you see. I'll give you one you may not know. The frog god. Remember all the frogs came up on land. Can you imagine how bad that? Have you ever encountered a dead frog, right? That your dog happened to find and rolls around in it, and then you pet that dog, right? Well, imagine, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of frogs all dead in Egypt. So the frog god in Egypt was, this is the name of the frog god, H-E-Q-T, Hecht. And so when God killed the frogs, he was killing one of their gods. The one that is most plain, I think, to you, and again, I'm sure you've heard a pastor or two besides me mentioned this, was of course the blotting out of the sun, and the sun god was Ra, of course, just R-A. Now that was the chief of gods except for Pharaoh, and so he comes against Pharaoh in what way? None other than killing his firstborn child, right, his firstborn son. And so Pharaoh was the one who caused Ra to come up and to go down. Pharaoh was in control of probably what the Egyptians would have thought as the chief of their gods. And so when God came against them, he came against all those created things that they had exalted to his position and his position only, all right? And so that's what Paul is talking about, different day and time, of course, but that's what Paul is talking about, is that, in fact, when you look at creation, it screams out that there has to be a creator. Matt Shattuck, our video guy, and I were talking about this, and he was talking about how, well, as soon as you and your spouse have a baby, that's when your understanding of God is deepened, right? Think about what happens. You know, I won't get indelicate on a Wednesday night, but two little cells come together. One of them swims around until it finds the other one, right? What is that thing that we call a sperm, right? They swim around, or it swims around until it finds the other one. The two match up, things begin to split, and 9 months later, out pops Junior, right? Just that alone screams out, what? Are you kidding me? There has to be, you see, again, the creation screams out that there is a creator. All right, let me just leave you in this segment with one more thought. Again, the catechism continues to be, in my estimation, a very helpful tool for us. I know many of you had bad experiences with the catechism when you were required to go for 3 to 5 hours on a Wednesday or on a Saturday, but notice what Luther writes about the first article. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe that God has made me and all creatures, that he's given me my body and soul, eyes and ears and all my members, my reason and all my senses, and he still takes care of them. That last sentence I just read is important. Still takes care of them. He also gives me clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, spouse and children, land, animals, and all that I have. He richly and daily provides me with all that I need to support this body and life. He defends me against all danger and guards and protects me from all evil. All this he does only out of fatherly divine goodness. He is our heavenly Father. Fatherly divine goodness and mercy without any merit or worthiness in me. And for all this, it is my duty to thank, praise, serve, and obey him. And all the Missouri Synod Lutherans said this is most certainly true, right? Now, I will tell you, I get shivers every time I read that, because when I was confirmed, you had to be in front of the entire congregation and recite a part of the catechism. Remember that? There were about 900 people in the sanctuary, and Pastor Hoffman hands me the mic and says, Joe, I'd like you to give me the explanation of the first article. So every time I read it, I kind of go like this, right? You know, just that wonderful experience that we gave, all right? So again, this is our faith statement, that God made it all. But I'm going to go back to it. This is the cool part about this. It's also logical. You have to come to that realization that there is a God. you know, I don't think you guys are struggling with it, but I have a feeling there are people in your life that are struggling with it. Ask them, where did the junk come from? Where did it come from? It's a pertinent question. You cannot dismiss it. You can't simply set it aside. You have to say, the universe itself screams out that God has created it. All right. So, in a sense, Villain can got at the next question, and that is, if we know God exists, what existed before God? This is the grand question I get from children all the time. Who is God's creator, right? Now, this is the hard part. You know, all I said was absolutely logical that God is the creator of the universe and all of that stuff, but this is where our faith gets stretched, and we have to simply say, we don't believe that there was a creator of God. God simply always was, and always is, and always will be. And I know that sounds like we've gone from logic boat to faith boat, or logic boat to illogical, right? But if he is God, the supreme being, the supreme creator, then that answer is an acceptable answer. Now, scripturally, I'm just going to take you to a place that says that. All right, so why don't we go to the Revelation. I could take you to several places, by the way. But the Revelation, chapter 1, verses 4 to 8. So, oh yeah, I was going to write those down for you. So Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 to 8. Okay. So John writes this. Remember that it is the revelation of Jesus Christ. But he writes this, John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the rulers of the kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega. So, Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Again, the idea being that if there is a supreme being, and in my estimation, it's the only, unless you got another logical explanation for the junk, it's the only logical explanation. And if there is a supreme being, then we simply have to rest back and say, I can't explain it. It is not explainable. I can't explain it. And so I simply have to rest on, he's always been there. He just simply always has. Now, that I realize what that's doing to your brain. It's the flat line, right? I understand that. But what other, I'm not even going to ask the question. I know there's no other answer to that question. He has to always have been. And that's what the Bible continues to say about him, that he always has been. So again, I put there two points, and again, in mine it's highlighted. It's not in yours, but in answer number six, A6, I say, we know that there's a creator since the creation gives evidence of that fact, and it is the only logical option. Therefore, if there is a creator God, then that creator God is and always will be something we don't fully understand. If God is completely knowable, then he is no longer God, but one of us. And so this is the thing. Gosh, I just got interviewed by four high school students from Des Moines Christian. Great questions. I mean, they ask some really awesome questions. I'm just always amazed, by the way, by the question that I mentioned this to Chris Thompson. The question that I continually get is, if God is a good God, why is there suffering in this world? And that's a question that's very easily answered. God remains a good God. We're the problem. We're why there's suffering in this world. It's all on us. And, oh, by the way, I didn't intend to get into this, but this idea, you know, we say, well, why doesn't God just control bad people? Well, you know, we want God to control, but we don't want him to control us, right? I want to do what I want to do, God. And so we like the idea of the marionette, God, keep bad things from happening, but not when it comes to my life. Lord, control those other people, just don't control me, you see. And so God is a good and gracious God, and he allows us. I mean, frankly, we ought to be happy he didn't squash us like a bug in the Garden of Eden, right? But he allows us to kind of do our own thing, and that's why evil continues to exist. Don't forget, by the way, that this earth is still under a curse from God. It was redeemed by Jesus Christ. There's no question about that. But we remain under the curse that happened in the garden when God cursed the ground. We are groaning because of that curse that happened long ago. All right? So the reason I mentioned the young people is they brought up this very question of, you know, where did God come from question. It's a question that I hear over and over and over again from young people especially. It's a tough one because for them, they're children. And so what do they say? I have a mom and a dad, so God had a mom and a dad, right? And so on down the line. In fact, one of the more bizarre things about Mormonism is that very thing. You have a father God and a mother God, and they punch out baby spirit babies for eternity. And I think I've told some of you ladies that in the Mormon religion, of course, your husband will be a god, and he will call you forth from the grave if you cooked dinner well, and if you didn't, he'll call some other chick forward, and they'll have spirit babies for the rest of forever, all right? Again, we just simply have to rest and say we don't completely understand. All right, let's get to Q7. This is the one I really wanted to get to tonight. Q7 is, can I be a Christian and believe in evolution? This is a pertinent question for several reasons. Not the least of which, I realize I'm not stupid. I realize that there are many people in our congregation that struggle with the idea of creationism versus evolution. I will tell you this, many people in our congregation, maybe that's too strong, several people in our congregation want to try to make the two match or go together. What we would call theistic evolution, that God actually created evolution, got it going, and then just kind of sat back and played golf at Pebble Beach, right? We are, in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, hardcore creationists. There's no question about it. That is our denomination. But we are also loving people that say there are things that you're just flat going to struggle with, and so we wrap our arms around you. If in fact, you say to me, I do not believe that Jesus lived, died, and rose again, we got a whole bigger issue than if you say to me, I struggle with this idea of creation versus evolution. Those are two different monkeys in my book, all right? Now, it is a tricky one, but let me begin by asking the question, what makes a person a Christian? Right? I mean, you have to start there. And Jesus is very point blank about what makes a person a Christian. So let's just look at the verses. You could probably quote Mark 16:16, but let's look it up anyway. Mark 16:16. Well, let's get the context while we're at it. We might as well do Bible study. So Mark 16:14 then, afterward, he, that is Jesus, appeared to the 11 themselves as they, remember 11 because Judas Iscariot is no longer there, as they were reclining at table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. And these are the words that are important. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And so what is it that makes a person a Christian? Faith in Jesus Christ, his life, death, and resurrection, and baptism in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's what makes a person a Christian. Struggling with creation and evolution does not thereby deny your Christian faith. Now, I am going to make the point that you got some issues. If you deny Adam and Eve, you got some issues over here for several reasons in the New Testament. I'm going to come to that in just a second. But I would never say that a person that is struggling again with creation evolution is not a Christian. Now, I will challenge you to say that you need to understand that evolution is as much a faith system as creationism is. Remember what I said a moment ago. The theory of evolution is not fact. It is a theory. Macroevolution, particularly. Now, microevolution, we do believe that things change. If you mate two different critters, and they have to be, you know, there's some speciation stuff going on, but you mate two different critters, you're going to get it. And the example I always use is in Oklahoma, we had Bassadors. There was a Labrador that got in and impregnated three full-blood Basset hounds, all right? The Basset owner was thrilled. Of course, those three Basset ladies pumped out about 15 kids apiece. So, yeah, it was crazy. When we went over, there were puppies everywhere, all right? But so you had a Labrador and a Basset hound. They made it, and out came what is actually a breed now. It's called a Bassador, all right? Now, understand what happened. There was change. We know that things change. It happens. Would we say that's evolution? No, we would say that things change. Now, that's observable and repeatable and scientific, but macroevolution is not. Macroevolution, understand, saying that from a single cell organism, I'm not even going to go Big Bang with you on this thing, all right? A single cell organism in a pool of ooze over here a couple of trillion years ago eventually birthed all living things, plants, animals, humans, everything came from a single cell in a pool of ooze that got struck by a bolt of lightning. Please, Christian, don't tell me that doesn't take faith to believe. I saw Bill Nye the Science Guy. You ever seen that guy? Bill Nye the Science Guy. He's got this huge diorama. Over here is Homo sapiens. Over here is the pool of ooze. He's standing here and he picks it up. There's this green soupy stuff in the pool of ooze, and he's got a ladle, and he says, this is where all life began. And I'm going, Bill Nye, you're brilliant, and yet that's ridiculous. But again, they say if given enough time, this thing popped out. The truth of the matter is, I'm going to go right back to it. Come on, Christian, it takes more faith to believe that from a single cell critter, all life came into being than it does to simply say, God stuck his hands in the dirt and pulled out Adam, and then from his rib, I said her rib last week, by the way, we still believe Adam was a man, all right? So from his rib, fashioned Eve. Why is that hard to believe? Because you understand, science isn't proven anything in this area. It's still the theory of evolution. My recommendation to you is to understand that fact, that they're both faith systems. And I personally think it takes less faith to believe that God created all the junk, including Adam and Eve. All right? Okay, thank you for listening. I appreciate that. Let me just bolster you one more time, because I know I can say that all day long. You're still going to have questions and doubts. So let me give you one. I'm going to lift you up one more time. Look at Romans 10, 9 to 11. Just to remind you that what makes a Christian is where we're at. Romans 10, 9 to 11. So I'll split the verse. So if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For Scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. Now notice how basic it really is. Is trusting, again, this part you have to have, trusting in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that through faith in him and his life, death, and resurrection, you will be in heaven forever. And yes, again, I'm just pulling scriptures out. We combine those two, if you believe in, are baptized. We those two go together, all right? So it's baptism and faith into Jesus that makes you a Christian. So can you be a Christian and still believe in evolution? The answer is yes. Now, your brother Joe is going to do everything he possibly can to dissuade you from believing in evolution, but I'm going to say, ultimately, being a Christian is about faith in Jesus Christ, okay? All God's people said? Amen. You don't seem very, that was half-hearted, but we'll go with it, all right? So that's fine, all right? So that's answer seven. Answer 7A, this is the challenge now that I'm going to bring to you. While that's true, but as a Christian, we've already gone over this, you believe that the Bible is God's word. If the Bible is God's word, then the Bible has to be true. All right? So I'll just give you the verses again. John 17:17 and Psalm 18:30. Let's do this. Look at Psalm 18:30. I'll quote for you John 17:17. Jesus said, sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. All right? So now look at Psalm 18:30. We did this just last week or so. Psalm 18, verse 30. So the psalmist writes there, this God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in him. So this is the thing. If the Bible is God's word, again, I'm just going to do the logical steps, then the Bible must be true because God's word is true right here. And I believe me, I admit the circular reasoning. I'm proving it to you from the Bible, so I get that, all right? But again, it's a faith statement. So if the Bible is God's word, which is a faith statement in and of itself, then it must be true. And so the struggle that you're going to have is this. What was going on in the early chapters of Genesis? If, let's say, evolution is true, what was going on in the early chapters of Genesis when God disseminated Genesis to Moses? Was he telling him a fib? Because often what people say to me is that God gave to Moses that which he could handle and only what he could handle. And so he gave him, told him a story about creation rather than telling him the truth, which was that, and I trust me, if you got an issue with creation evolution, likely you are a theistic evolutionist, which means you think that God started evolution and just kind of let it go its way, all right? So I'm assuming that. So the problem with that is this. If God, let's just say it's true, God started evolution and walked away from it and let it do its thing, and then told Moses that on day one he created light, on day two, on day three, on day four, on down the line, then God was telling Moses a fib, which makes God what? A liar. And the question comes, not only is God's word true, question mark, but is it possible for God to lie? Because even if it's a fib, you understand it. Now, come on, moms and dads in the room, right? Would you let your kids come to you and say, oh, it's just a fib, mom. I was over at my boyfriend's house when you told me not to, but it was just a fib. It wasn't a lie. No, a fib, right, is a lie, all right? And so the question comes, can God lie? Well, that's why I have the Titus chapter 1, verses 1 to 4 verse in there. So look at Titus chapter 1. Titus is in the T's, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, and then Titus, all right? It's not really in the T's, it just sort of is, all right? Titus, very small book, chapter 1. So Titus chapter 1, verses 1 to 4 reads this way, Paul, servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect, that is the Christians, and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness in hope of eternal life. Remember, that's not I hope so, but the surety of eternal life, which God, who never what? Lies, promised before the ages began and at the proper time manifested in his word through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God our Savior. And let me just finish it. To Titus, my true child, in common faith, grace, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. God cannot, a perfect, pure, holy, righteous God cannot fib or lie because it's contrary to his nature. So for him to tell Moses something contrary to what actually happened would actually make God a liar. It'd be contrary to who he is, all right? So in fact, I would even ask this question. if you believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and again, I'm assuming if you're a Christian, you do. So if you believe in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, why do you trust that part of the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all right, but you don't trust Genesis? Why do you say, well, Jesus, who, by the way, in John 10 says he's going to raise himself from the dead, why do you believe that that is true, but you don't believe that God could stick his hands in the mud and pull out Adam and Eve, all right? To me, that why not? I mean, if I trust that on the third day he rose again from the dead, I'm going to trust that God in a six-day period. In fact, I think most of you have heard me say this. Why did it take God so long to create everything? 6 days? He doesn't need 6 days, right? He doesn't even need 6 seconds. He can just, bam, will it into existence, you see. And so, in fact, I would say if you trust life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, then you should, in fact, trust Adam and Eve. Now, there actually is more to it than that, all right? There's more to it than that. I should pause here for a second and remind you that the word, it's often said, well, maybe what the word day meant was actually hundreds of thousands or millions of years, but the word in Hebrew is yom, Y-O-M, for day, and that's the word that is used, a 24-hour period, day one, day two, day three, it's all just a day. It's the normal usage of the word day. It's not equal to a million years, all right? Again, similar to God didn't lie to Moses when he told him that, all right? So there's a couple of other things here. The first thing is this. I want to remind you of something, that Jesus believed in Adam and Eve. So I'm going to go back to it, my Christian friend. If you believe in Jesus and you believe that what the Gospels say, I'm just going to take Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, for example, say about Jesus is true, well, Jesus believed in Adam and Eve. And so if it's good enough for the Lord of glory, I would suggest it should be good enough for you and me. So let's look at a couple of passages. I want to first establish that he believes in the Old Testament. So look at Matthew 12, the veracity of the Old Testament, I should say. Matthew 12, verses 38 and following. Again, this is just an Old Testament that Christ believes in the Old Testament, and then I'll take you to Adam and Eve in a second. Oh, and I'm sorry, I don't think you have this, do you? Do you have the Matthew 12 reference? You do, okay. I'm going to write it up anyway. Okay. I'm sure my handwriting made it even better. So, all right. So Matthew 12, 38 to 41, remembering that Jesus is believing in the Old Testament, then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him saying, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he, that is Jesus, answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, someone greater than Jonah is here." So again, Christ believed in the veracity of the Old Testament. He believed that a guy was stuck in the belly of a fish for 3 days and three nights, and didn't say, now there's this story in the Old Testament that is just a way of pointing to me. He said, just like Jonah, the guy, the prophet, and in fact mentions the fact that he prophesied to Nineveh, and Nineveh repented, if you recall the story. Now, look at Mark 10:6. Now, this one you may not have in your thing. Mark 10:6. Excuse me, sniffling up here. And I won't give you the context. You are welcome to deal with the context on your own, but Jesus says this, from the beginning of creation, God made them what? yeah, male and female. Therefore, man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God, this is what's in the marriage ceremony, of course, what God has joined together, let no man take apart or put asunder or tear apart. All right. So remembering, again, Jesus believed in Adam and Eve. Jesus believed that the story of creation was true. And if it's good enough for my Lord Jesus, it's good enough for me. Okay. The last thing I'll tell you in this regard, biblically speaking, is this. The problem if you get rid of Adam and Eve and go to an evolution scheme is that the whole basis of Jesus Christ coming into our world to die for the sins of the world is all based in the fall in the Garden of Eden of Adam and Eve, all right? And in fact, Paul takes that up in the book of Romans. And so you should have the reference, Romans 5, verses 12 to 15. So let's look at that, and then I'll give you one last biblical thing. So Romans 5, 12 to 15. So Paul writes there, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, that is Adam, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin was indeed in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet, notice the effect of sin, because it's a disease, not just something you don't, you know, you're disobedient, but it's a disease that infects your body. So he says this, yet death, the effect of sin, death reigned from Adam, notice, again, he believes it, to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who is the type of the one to come. And here's the good news, the free gift is not like the trespass, for if the many died through the one man's trespass, how much more have the grace of God and the free gift by that grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And so the entire basis, remember, of the Christian faith is based on the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden being a true event that brought sin into our world that had to be remedied by the death and resurrection of the second Adam, as we often call him, the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, let me give you one more biblical thing to just, you know, get up in your cranium, and it's this. The Bible says the wages of what is death? The wages of sin is death. So what that means is if you decide in theistic evolution to say God started the pool of ooze thing and eventually we got all the way down to, you know, some people even say down to Adam and Eve. They were eventually, you know, maybe they were Neanderthals, something like that. I've seen all sorts of schemes. This is the problem that you have. Nothing could die until Adam and Eve sinned in the garden. There was no death before Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, you see. So no dinosaurs, no animals, no cheetahs or giraffes or hippopotamuses or anything else could die until sin was brought into the world, you see. Plants would be a different subject because they don't have what the Bible calls, it's a great Hebrew word, the nephesh, the life in them. They don't have that, but critters and humans do, so nothing could have died until sin. So you see, the problem is, there's actually, you create a larger issue for yourself believing in theistic evolution than you do to trust that God just made two critters named Adam and Eve. And the rest is history, right? All right. So let me give you, oh man. Guess what we're going to be doing again next week. So I'm going to just give you one thing to think about. This is I'm out of time just about. So this has always been my way of helping Christians to get to a better place when it comes to evolution. And it's this. I call it the one bad apple spoils the whole bunch rule. All right. So the rule is this, one bad apple spoils a whole bunch. I think you understand. If there's a bad apple in there, everything else is going to get soured. All right. So the bad apple spoiling the whole bunch in evolution is this. If one animal could not have evolved, if I can find one animal where it's impossible for it to have evolved, then you understand the whole theory of evolution is done. Because it would have had to have been created, you understand? So if it had to be created, then what? The whole bunch of apples had to be created, you see. So what do we do with that? Well, I could give you probably 30 critters where their evolution is impossible to have happened, all right? There's this one, it's this English woodpecker. It's the most bizarre thing I've ever seen in my life, but its tongue goes down the back of its throat, up and out the back of its skull, and comes back down, and then goes out of its mouth. Now, you tell me, from what you know about evolution, that there was a purpose for this thing to have. What would be the evolutionary purpose of sending that critter's tongue out the back of its head and up and down through its nose and back out its beak? There is no evolutionary purpose. You know what that is? That's God messing with humans that believe in evolution is what that is. I'll tell you what, I'll make a really weird one, all right? Oh, and while we're talking about weird ones, this is my favorite. Most of you have heard me do this before. How about that thing called the duck-billed platypus, all right? Is it a duck or is it a beaver, right? Is it a party gone wrong, right? What happened? Is it a duck or is it a beaver? Now, I'm going to add one to it for you. I don't know if you know this. Those of you that have been in my Bible studies, I know you've heard me say this. The question is it a duck, is it a beaver, or is it a snake? Now, why do I say that? Well, the male duck-billed platypus actually has a spur on its back leg. And that spur, now listen closely, injects venom. Yeah, and you say, oh, well, Pastor, only snakes have venom. You must be incorrect. Oh, no, I'm correct. The duck-billed platypus has a duck bill and a tail like a beaver and a fang hanging off of its leg like a rattlesnake. This is really a bad party, let me tell you, all right? So where did it come from? It's in my estimation, now I'm sure there's someone that could say to me, well, this is how that critter came to be, but I'm going to say as I look at it as a thinking human being, that had to be created, that thing, all right? The other one, that one of my favorites, is the giraffe. The giraffe's heart, I am 6 feet tall, or as my chiropractor said, you used to be 6 feet tall, Joe, all right? So I'm 6 feet tall. A giraffe's heart is the size of my body. It's 2 meters long. And so it has to be that to shove the blood up, and you understand, up that big old hunk of neck. Now, the problem with that is when the giraffe leans over and drinks water, the blood pressure is so strong, it would maul its brain. It would just absolutely make its brain mush. So the giraffe has 2 little flaps in its neck where the blood is rushing that go shut when it leans it. So when it leans forward, it just goes and shuts off the blood from getting to its brain and making, you know, mashed potatoes out of its brain. This is the problem with the theory. Evolutionists would say, I'm being intentionally sarcastic, that the giraffe needed 2 little valves in its neck, and so it over time developed those 2 valves. The problem with theories like that is that it could not have happened before they were extinct. They would have blown their brains out. I mean, just to be crass, they would all been dead. They never would have developed it, you see. And a similar critter to that is called the bombardier beetle. The bombardier beetle is one of my favorites, very highly contested, by the way, as to what this thing, where it got its ability to do this. But the bombardier beetle combines 2 chemicals that, when they come into contact with oxygen, create like an ammonia gas that it burns. So if a bird is flying after it, it lets the gas come out, it burns the bird figures it out and doesn't eat it, all right, doesn't want to eat it. So the problem, again, is there needs to be some slowing down. Now, I'm gonna explain this, and then I'm going to retract it in just a second. For years, we thought that what there was an inhibitor, a 3rd chemical in its body that kept it from exploding until it hit the oxygen. Now, it seems like that might not actually be the case, but I was telling Chris Thompson, it just cracks me up. I'm reading this article about, well, it seems like that 3rd chemical probably isn't the case, an inhibitor, you know, maybe not happening, but, and by the way, they didn't deny that it could be happening, and you understand, this design requires a designer, ladies and gentlemen, all right, because they would have all been blown up and done, they would have never evolved, you see, But he goes on to explain how intricate this system is of bringing these chemicals together, that there are these pores within the body that release the things just at the right time. And that all proves that evolution is true, he gets to. And I'm like, what? I'm going to take you back to the watch, Christian. Saying that all this stuff that's all intricate, and by the way, you and I are far more intricate than this Timex watch, that all this intricate stuff just popped together is ludicrous. It requires a designer. And I know what you're saying. Oh, I believe that, Pastor. But I believe God designed it and just set it on its way. This is the last thing I'm going to leave you with tonight. And by the way, next week, I want to talk about carbon-14 dating. Some of you have asked me about carbon-14 dating. I have some answers for you on that. But I want to leave you with this. If you believe that God created this magnificent watch known as the universe, set it aside and just let it do its thing, then you don't know the God of the Bible. See, the God of the Bible, according to Jesus, sends his rain on the unrighteous and the righteous, sends the sun to shine on the unrighteous and the righteous. He maintains his creation. That's why I read to you from the Catechism where it says, and still takes care of them. That's the God of the Bible, Christian. He's not a set this thing in motion and walk away and say, hey, I hope it works out cool for you. You know, I hope you guys find your way and eventually I'll fix things up for you. No, he's a God that's intimately involved. And I would suggest to you, Genesis, from the beginning all the way to the end of the book in the Revelation, it's all true and it's all accurate. And you can hang your hat on it. And I'm just going to say this last thing, and it's this. You know what? I will always be that Christian. I will always be, until the day I walk into the grave, a person that trusts that God's word is absolutely true. And it's my job as your pastor and brother in Christ, Lord willing, his spirit, to help you get to that place too. Now, before I pray, I want to say this. I'm intense about this stuff, you can tell, right? But I want you to hear me say this. If you're struggling, we're going to come to this segment in just a second. Sorry. In a week or two, just a second is not true, but in a week or two, you know what? If you have doubts about this stuff, it's okay. Please don't hear my intensity as judgment. It's not that. It's just that I know it's true. I know it's true. And every fiber of my being, I want you to know it's true too. But please don't walk away saying, man, Joe's mad at me. Joe doesn't think I'm a good Christian, because none of that is true at all. I want to help you to get to a different place, and that's it, all right? All right, cool. Thank you for listening. I've done my aerobics for the evening. I will now go home to the lazy boy recliner. So let's pray. God, we love you, and we thank you and praise you for your word. We thank you, Lord, even though there are struggles, even though we have things in your word that are tough to understand, we thank you that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you help us day by day to grasp it even better. And pray, Lord, and I pray for my brothers and sisters in this room, those watching on live stream, those that will watch this tape in the future. Lord, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would strengthen their faith in Jesus every day and help them to love your word too. We thank you for this time. We pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said again.